Well, it's a delight to be here. Turn with me, please, to the book of James. The book of James. And thank you, Pastor Coons, for the topic. I asked him, I said, do we have a theme? And he says, well, sometimes we do and sometimes we don't. And I said, would you like to? And he said, I'd kind of like to have the theme of the book, the blood, and the blessed hope. And that has worked out to some real good quality study time for my own heart, for my own soul. And I'm excited to share that with you folks as we dig in together to the Word of God in James chapter 1. If you'd follow along silently as I read, please. James chapter 1, beginning in verse 19. James chapter 1, verse 19. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he, being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. If any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction and to keep himself unspotted from the world. Amen. Father in heaven, oh, how we thank you that we even have the privilege to be here today to talk with you, to pray, essentially to declare our dependence upon you. We remind ourselves that as we abide in you, we can bear much fruit. We remind ourselves that the very same verse says that without you, we can do nothing. Lord, as these men and women, some children are gathered here today, we ask that at the end of our sessions tomorrow, having heard plenty from your word to all who will minister that way, that we would go out these doors saying, it's been good, it's been a good conference. Amen. And yet, ultimately, we ask that that would also be your evaluation, that from your perspective, this might be good, it might be profitable, it might be edifying to us. And so we commit ourselves to you. We're glad that we have your word. Without it, we could talk and it wouldn't matter. With it, we can have our lives changed. We're glad that we don't have to ask you to be with us. We don't presume upon you, but we know that according to your word, you're here, and that your spirit dwells among us and in us. And so we just place ourselves before you and we say, thy will be done. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
In our sessions, we are going to be looking at the Word of God, the blood of Christ, the blessed hope, and how that applies to us and how God desires to make a change in our lives. This very first topic, as we dig into the book, I remind us that this book is the greatest of all books. It's not the book of the year, it is the book of all ages. It's the book of books.
Yes.
The Bible has outlived and outlifted and outsold and outlooked and outloved and outreached, outranked and outblessed every other book.
Right.
Only ignorance scoffs at the Bible.
Yes.
For it is the most interesting of all books. It is inspired.
Yes.
Of God. It is God-breathed. Holy men of God were carried along like wind in the sails as they wrote what God wanted them to write. In this book, there is a story of a man that lived to be 969 years old in Genesis chapter 5. A baby born with a scarlet cord around his wrist in Genesis 38. A man who was talked to by a donkey.
Yes.
In Numbers 22. A man with a bed that was 13 and a half feet long and 6 feet wide. In Deuteronomy 3, verse 11. A woman who had to shave her head before marriage in Deuteronomy 21. Tells a story in Joshua chapter 10 of the day that the sun stood still. Someone says, you believe that?
Yes.
I do.
Yeah.
I believe that God can take a hell-bound, hell-deserving sinner and somehow equip him, me, and make me fit for heaven. I can believe the rest of this.
Yes.
There was a woman who killed a man by driving a nail through his skull in Judges chapter 4. And an army of 700 left-handed men in Judges 20. There was a man who got a once-a-year haircut, and it weighed 6.5 pounds in 2 Samuel chapter 14, and the sad story of one who cooked and ate their own son in 2 Kings chapter 6. An axe head that floated in 2 Kings. A man with 12 fingers and 12 toes in 2 Samuel 21. A father with 88 children in 2 Chronicles chapter 11. An army of 185,000 men who were destroyed in one night in Isaiah chapter 37. And interestingly enough, to read that same story, when we use extra biblical material, it's okay to do that as long as we put the Bible up here and the extra biblical material is down here. And I remember reading of the Taylor Prisms of this very story in Scripture. Doesn't say that it's Scripture. And that evil king, Zahad Sennacherib, surrounded like a bird in a cage. And then the next entry in his log says, oh, we decided to go home. He doesn't tell us that he lost 185,000 troops. And this is extra biblical material. The Taylor Prisms are in a museum in England. And I think, wow, not that that proves the Bible. I believe it by faith without apology.
Amen.
Faith is the medium of exchange. If we want to deal with God, if we want to do business with God,
yes,
it's the way we do that. We do it by faith. Make no apology that we say we believe the Bible by faith. There's a preacher whose wife died in Ezekiel 24, and God said, don't mourn. A preacher who ate locusts in Matthew chapter 3.
Yes.
And we know that Jesus was one of at least 7 children of Mary in Matthew chapter 13. And we know of a man that the Bible says, I delivered unto you, first of all, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture.
Yes.
That he was buried and he rose again the third day.
Yes.
According to the Scripture.
Amen.
Amazing, amazing truth. We learn from 2 Timothy chapter 3 in verse 16 that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. It is God-breathed, and it is profitable. If the verse ended there, it would be a wonderful verse. But we're glad that it doesn't. I remember as a 19-year-old in Phillipsburg, Montana, in what became a little Continental Baptist mission church. I was working in the sawmill. I was a millwright, and I had the freedom to be wherever I wanted to be. I didn't have a production job, but as long as when something broke down, they would blow that whistle signal. One whistle meant the head rig was broke down, and I'd run over to the head rig. And two whistles meant the edger was broke down, and I'd go over to the edger and fix that. And three whistles meant the debarker was broke down. And so on and so forth. So I had privilege to be wherever I wanted to be. And I've always been an encourager, even before I was saved. And I saw this new boy. He was in his 40s. I was just a kid, but when you started in the sawmill, you're a new boy, didn't matter how old you were, and he was shoveling wet sawdust under a conveyor system, and the sawdust is going down his neck, and the water from the head rig is going down his back and getting him all wet, and the shrill of the head rig just roaring like a big whistle as they cut log after log, and he's down below there trying to catch up, and I grabbed a scoop shovel. And I helped him clean out the job. And we stopped for a minute to say hello, and I introduced myself. He told me he was a Baptist preacher. And he said he had a missionary in his church that night. And would I come and hear the missionary? Dear people, I don't know that I'd ever heard the term missionary. I didn't know what a missionary was. I didn't know what a missionary did. And that night I went to Flint Creek Baptist Church in Phillipsburg, Montana, and I heard for the very first time that Jesus Christ died for the sins of the world. I heard that Jesus Christ died for me. Before that time, if someone would have said to me, let me share John 3:16, turn to the book of John, I would not have known how to find the book of John. I would not have known even what he was talking about. And that night, that man said that we were all sinners. I didn't have any trouble with that. My dear wife, Terry, who's a very godly woman, our first dates as 17-year-olds were in the bars in Butte, Montana. And I knew I was a sinner. He said I couldn't save myself. I didn't have any trouble believing that either. And he said that Jesus Christ died for me. That's good news. I didn't know that. And that if I would receive Christ as my Savior, as a free gift, that he would save me. And that night, hearing the gospel for the very first time, I responded and received Jesus Christ as my Savior. No one stood before me and gave me an anatomy lesson in the Bible, and there's nothing wrong with that. But no one told me that all Scripture is inspired of God. No one told me that inspired meant God breathed. I just believed that man when he stood before me and read out of the Bible that this must be God's Word.
Amen.
I've since had the anatomy lessons. I understand what God breathed means. I understand what Peter said and what he meant, that holy men of God were carried along as they wrote Scripture. But my basis for believing the Word of God is the same. It is by faith.
Amen.
And so we see that in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. But it doesn't end there. It's profitable for doctrine. I was in our church in First Baptist in Cedar Springs, Michigan, where we go, and I've only been there twice in about 15 months. My pastor said, you're about my most unfaithful member. He's also the chairman of the board of Continental Baptist Missions. And I said, yeah, I'm there on Wednesdays most of the time, unless I'm out having meetings. But he says, yeah, we're talking to the board and talking about discipline. I said, really? I said, I have last month's tithe and this month's tithe in my pocket. He says, we'll hold off the discipline. It is profitable for doctrine. I heard our pastor announce to the young marrieds, I'm going to be teaching a class on doctrine. And one of the girls said, one of the young ladies, oh no, I just as well stay home. I don't understand that deep stuff. Doctrine. Doctrine is what you believe.
Amen.
And certainly there's some deep stuff.
Yes.
But if you believe that Jesus died for you, that's doctrine.
Amen.
If you believe that he rose again, that's doctrine. If you believe that you have to receive Christ as your Savior, John chapter 1, verse 12. That's doctrine. The first church we started in Beverly Hills, Florida, I was 33 years old, and they gave us a piece of property, the Beverly Hills Development Corporation. We saw both of the owners millionaires. We saw both of the owners accept Jesus Christ as Savior. They gave us a piece of property, and they gave a piece of property to the charismatic church right next to us. Today, that's the new building of Heritage Baptist Church next to us. But I remember I was working out front and we were building the building and I was doing stonework out front and I was about 4 tiers high on the scaffolding. I had my 5-year-old sons, twin boys, up there with me. They knew their boundaries. Well, they did. They went up there. Thursday was my day to teach and we homeschooled our kids. So they were up there and they knew not to get too close to the edge. We only wanted obedient children. So, and all 4 of our children, we used to have 6, but no, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. So I saw Rocky, the charismatic pastor. He's walking around the circle as he did, and we just holler hello. But this day he took a diversion from his walk around the circle. It was the center of the community, and he walked right toward me, so I came down off the scaffolding. And I met Rocky, and we shook hands, and he says, Bill, this just isn't right. And I said, what? And he says, you're building a church right here. And I said, good observation. And he says, and we're going to build a church right there. And he says, that's just not right. He says, why don't we get together and forget doctrine? And he says, we'll just teach that Jesus loves us. And I went, hold it! And I did, and he kind of jumped back. And he said, what? I says, that's doctrine. He said, what? I said, you said let's forget our doctrine. And we'll just teach that Jesus loves us and that doctrine.
Amen.
So we're not going to forget all of our doctrine, are we? Well, no, I suppose not. Where do we draw the line? Well, if there is a line, let's draw it before Genesis and after Revelation. Let's leave the whole book. So all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. It is profitable for doctrine to tell you what to believe.
Yes.
To tell you what to believe. It's not only profitable for doctrine, but for reproof.
Yes.
To tell you where you've gone wrong.
Yes.
Now, I'm glad the verse doesn't end there. Here, the Bible tells you where you've gone wrong, period. No, no, no. It's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, to tell you how to get right back.
Yes.
Align yourself with God.
Yes.
And then it says, for instruction in righteousness, or to keep going the right way.
Yes.
And it says that the man of God, and you dear people understand that it means the person of God, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. What a thought, dear people. If you know Christ as Savior, you are thoroughly furnished unto all good works. We're not lacking in anything.
Amen.
How many of you old-timers older than me or my age remember the Guns of Will Sonnet? Some of you remember the Guns of Will Sonnet, played by Walter Brennan? You know, he was a war hero. He gave away his mask when they had mustard gas, and that's what wrecked his voice. And that's really what made him famous, was that very distinct voice. Grandpa McCoy. And Walter Brennan was a gunslinger. And he was looking for his son, who was a gunslinger. And he was with his grandson. And he was a gunslinger. But they were good gunslingers. They only killed the bad people. My kind of gunslinger. And then Grandpa McCoy would do something. Maybe it was a quick draw. Or maybe it was cooking beans over the fire. And he would get a compliment, and he would say, does anyone remember what he would say?
No brag, just fact.
No brag, just fact. Dear people, we stand before God thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Colossians chapter 2:10 says you are complete in Him who is the head of all principality and power. The Bible says He has given unto us all things that pertain to life and godliness.
Yes.
No brag. Just fact. Wow, that's who we are in Christ.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
Wow, the Scripture. That the man of God may be thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So how can we be good receivers or welcomers of the Word of God? The main text that we're going to look at, the main verse, is verse 21. He says, wherefore lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness. Isn't that a mouthful? Superfluity of naughtiness. We'll explain that. And receive with meekness. There's our theme. The book. How can I receive with meekness? Or how can I be a welcomer of the word? My spell check kicks that back to me and says it's not a word, but I choose to disagree. How can we welcome the Word of God? How can we receive with meekness the engrafted Word? Well, the Bible tells us in this passage. First of all, I'd like to see more than that. I believe the Bible teaches, look at verse 21, that the first thing we need to do whenever we hear the Word of God in any setting, whether it's our own devotions, whether it's listening to the preacher, if you're not the preacher, I love to preach, but I love to listen to preachers. Whether you're driving down the road and maybe listening to a good sermon, these will apply to any time that you're listening to the Word of God. Number one, consider the possibility that you need to receive the Word of God with repentance. Look what it says here. Lay apart. The word lay apart means to cast off. It's to put or putting away. It means to lay down. It means to lay aside. And it requires some effort on your part. It was a word that was used in Acts chapter 7, verse 58. The witnesses in stoning Stephen laid down, same word, they laid down their clothes at a young man's feet. His name was Saul. If I was thinking today, it's too warm up here. I wish my coat was off.
Take it off.
Yeah, it's easy. nothing happens. I need to take some action if I wanted to do that. And so we need to lay apart. And then he tells us what to lay apart. First of all, filthiness. I love the word studies, and by no means am I a Greek scholar, but I have some studies that I trust and some people that I trust. Unless that's the Lord, maybe we could... Oh, never mind. Filthiness. I was studying the Word. And you know, sometimes as you're studying the Word, maybe you misread something and you're going down the wrong... And I thought maybe that happened here. Because when I was studying this word filthiness, I found out that it's a medical term. I thought, a medical term? Lay apart all filthiness, and it's a medical term. I must have taken a wrong turn somewhere in my studies. I hadn't. It's a medical term that means wax in your ears. Ah, then it made sense. For he says to me, Bill, if you're going to be a receiver of God's word, consider the possibility that you need to repent and get any spiritual wax out of your ears. Are there some things that you may not want to listen to? We have four children. By God's grace, they love the Lord and serve the Lord. Our oldest is Scott. He's 38 years old. I had him when I was 12. We were driving west. And just before we left, we found out that Scott was having trouble hearing. You know, with a little kid, are they just ignoring you? Or is he having trouble hearing? And his ears were really plugged up. And we took him to the doctor just before we headed west. We're going to Montana. And we're cutting across Highway 2 in northern Montana. And just headed out that way. And as a truck would come by, it's just a two-lane road. And the truck would come by. And my son's ears are clean for the first time in who knows how long. We felt like neglectful parents. And a truck would go by and Scott would go, oh, what was that? Wow. Or he'd hear a bird sing and he'd say, listen. Or I watched him in the rearview mirror and he was going, both sides of his mouth. And listening to that, hearing things he never heard before, because he had wax in his ears. Dear people, likewise with you, with me. If I've got spiritual wax in my ears and I get rid of it through repentance, I'll hear things from God with a new clarity and say, whoa, what was that? Whoa, I never heard that before. Whoa, I never saw it in that light before. So he uses a medical term to warn of spiritual concern. My question to us today is, are there any wax in your ears? You say, Bill, wait a minute, you're talking to preachers and preachers' wives. And to that I say, is there any wax in your ears? We're not exempt. And then he says, also lay apart, not only spiritual wax in your ears, but also lay apart superfluity of naughtiness. That's a word that means superabundance of badness or leftover sins. Maybe something from your background, and that's just the way I am because of my background. My earliest memories of life are being in the bars with my dad. 5-year-old kid. Maybe I was 4. You know how you look back. How young was I when I was remembering that stuff? Fighting my way up to sit on the bar stool and leaning forward to put my elbows on the bar. And I was on a first name basis with the bartender. His name was Red. And I'd say Red as my dad sat and got drunk. I'd say Red. I want to have a party. I couldn't even say party right. And Red would fix me up with Orange Crush, saltine crackers, and sardines. And that was my party. I remember calling. Sometimes when I wasn't with my dad, the bartender wouldn't take my mom's calls, but he would take mine. He didn't have the heart to lie to me. And I talked to Dad on the phone, and he was about 7 miles away. He'd say, I'm headed home, Billy. I'll meet you at the highway. And I'd hike down to the highway about a mile away. Never dawned on me that he could drive 7 miles much faster than I could walk 1 mile. But I'd get out there on that highway and not many cars, and I'd see a car come straight stretch about 3/4 of a mile away, and I'd see a car come around a corner, and maybe it's Dad. And as the car got closer, I recognized that the headlights weren't ours, and the car would go on by. My mom had a nervous breakdown when I was a kid. I didn't have a civil conversation with my mother until after I was saved. I only say that to say, dear people, if any of us want to make excuses, I think I could move to the front of the line. Oh, that's just leftover stuff from my childhood. No, no, let's not do that. Any superfluity of naughtiness. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25 says, wherefore, putting away, the same word is taking off or lay apart, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 says, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Luke chapter 15, 21, 22. The story of the prodigal son as he comes home, he had rehearsed his story. And he says, the son said unto his father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said, one of his servants, bring forth the best robe. He said, put it on him, put a ring on his hand, and put shoes on his feet. Listen, dear people, the son was always the son. He never stopped being the son. But he wasn't useful because he's walking around in his old hog feeding clothes. Terry and I ride a big motorcycle. In fact, I just recently sold it. We traveled from Florida, 7,100 miles from Florida to Montana and into Idaho. Had to turn around in Idaho. It was the 5th of July and we hit a snowstorm. So, and we drove back home. Preached the whole way. Dr. Weber used to say, you play more than any man I know and still call it work. And we'll be talking a little bit about that because we ought to work hard and we ought to play hard too. In that order. In that order. And I'll tell you, riding that motorcycle, I was in Florida. We started four churches in Florida. And you smell things right over an overpass and when the orange blossoms. Or in Michigan, you smell the cherry blossoms. Wow. Or going through Nebraska. The feed loss. Do you know how far it is east to west in Nebraska? 17,000 miles on a motorcycle. It's a long ways. But there ain't nothing worse than being behind a hog feeding truck. You got to transport hogs. It's rancid. You just better pull over and let him get 200 miles down it and hope that he doesn't pull over and you end up behind him again anyway. And this young man was the father's son. But he was of no use to the father because he's walking around in his hog feeding clothes. I wonder why sometimes we may not be excited in the Word of God. Yes. Let's ask ourselves the question. Isn't it neat that the Holy Spirit lets us do that?
Yes.
I'm not going to try to jump on your toes. I'm really not. That's the Holy Spirit's job.
Amen.
But let's ask ourselves the question. Is there any spiritual wax in my ears? Anything that I refuse to listen to? Or are there any leftover sins in my life? Repent. Repent. Let's move on. We need to not only receive the Word of God with a repentance, but we need to receive the Word of God with a readiness. He says, receive with meekness the engrafted Word. Receive with meekness the engrafted Word. The word for meekness here. Meekness means to be compliant. Meekness means to have a ready spirit. So when you hear the Word of God, this is attitude. When you hear the Word of God, are you compliant? Do you have a ready spirit? Are you submissive? Are you manageable? Are you gentle? Oh, and dear people, don't confuse meekness with weakness. The two are not even related, as you well know. Meekness is teachability, it's trainability, it's being guidable. A few years ago, I got a call from a buddy of mine who runs an outfitter organization there in southwestern Montana. The Centennial Mountains, 37 miles on a dirt road east of I-15 as it heads north through Idaho, from Utah to Idaho and into Montana. We could stand on a mountain there in Montana and look south, and we look over Idaho at the Grand Tetons. Oh, it's beautiful. And Mel called me and he says, Bill, do you have some dates open in hunting season? I said, I did. And he says, would you come out? He says, I need help wrangling. I need help cooking. And he says, and I need help grizzly bear watch. See, what happens is, he has a group of hunters. And he takes one group of hunters. They're all finished with their week or 10 days. He takes them to the airport in Butte, Montana, or Idaho Falls, Idaho. And then he gathers up the other hunters. And, of course, this is all planned months and sometimes a couple years ahead of time, and he brings those other hunters in. And the camp is empty, and it's grizzly territory. And the grizzly bears recognize when there's no human presence in the camp. I love people, but I love to be away from people too. And I went up there, and I was all by myself. I never heard another human voice for 4 days and 3 nights. It was incredible. And I only saw one bear, and it got down to 35 below zero. And that bear was headed for hibernation. I'll tell you, he didn't want anything to do with us. I don't know what I'd do anyway. You can't shoot him. I guess you'd bang on pots and pans and say something mean about the bear's mama or something. I don't know. But I got on a horse my first trip in. We had to go 10 miles up a mountain. It's a steep mountain. You do switchbacks. And I got on this horse, and I'm leading 13 critters, horses and mules. I got on this horse, and I squeezed my knees together a little bit, and Ben took off like a rodeo horse. And I hollered to Mel. I said, Mel! I said, Ben's a rodeo horse! And he says, yeah, this is his first season in the woods. And I said, oh, joy! Great! We had to cross this creek about five times. That's right, creek. Where I come from, if you call it creep, they think you're a city slicker. So we had to cross this creek about five times to get up there. And it's the widest that's from here to the wall. But it's 35 below, so it's frozen. And so my job is to get Ben up there and get his front legs up there. And this is all new to him. He tries to get his hind legs up. I can't let him do that. Because even though the ice may be strong enough to hold us, if I go across, and then the next one goes across, and the next one, if one of those horses or mules fall through, we're in big trouble. And if you fall in the water at 35 below zero, you'll die. A friend in Michigan said, does that include the wind chill? Listen, when it's 35 below zero, you don't want to know how cold it really is. And so I get up there with Ben and get his front legs up there. He tried to get his hind legs up, and I bring him back. He didn't understand, but I was the master. And I'd march forward, and we'd fall through the ice the first time. You only fall about 2 feet. First time scared him. But he maintained control, and then put his front legs up there again, and I'd lurch forward, and he'd fall through again. One time we had to get off and bust it with a sledgehammer because he wouldn't fall through. But we had to make the trail through there. By the time we crossed about the fourth time, you know what that horse would do? He'd get up there and he'd put his front legs up there. And then even sometimes before I could lurch forward, he would put his weight forward. And he'd bust through the ice. Going up one of those mountains, we weld borium on the horseshoes so they don't slip. And you can go up ice. And going up one of those mountains this way, he wanted to run. And I'm on his back. You don't confuse meekness with weakness. That horse was not meek, but he was more usable than ever because he followed the master's, in that case, me. He followed the master's direction, even though he didn't understand. It wouldn't have done me any good at all to get off Ben, put my arm around him and say, now Ben, the reason we're going to break this ice is, that wouldn't have helped. But he was compliant. And he was more usable to us. Not all horses are usable. I have a number of friends who have horses and mules. Not all of them are usable in mountains. We got one off the racetrack in Spokane one time, and I'll tell you, he was a knucklehead. And he ended up being somewhere else. He's more usable because he was compliant. He was teachable. Dear people, we're more usable to God. If we will receive with meekness, it's a readiness, it's an attitude that says, okay, I'll obey the word of God. I love this. Acts chapter 24, verse 14 says, believing all things which are written in the law and prophets. Wow. That needs to be me. Believing all things that are written in the law and prophets. You see, part of our problem, dear people, even though we say we believe all scriptures given by inspiration of God, sometimes part of our problem, even preachers, even missionaries, sometimes part of our problem is when we hear the word of God, we parade it past the jury of our emotions to see if we're going to obey it. I know it's God's word, but look how I feel. Or we parade it past the jury of our circumstances. I know it's God's word, but look at these circumstances that I find myself in. Or we parade it past the jury of our background. Or parade it past the jury of our relationships. See if we'll obey it. We need to just obey the word. We need to believe all things which are written in the law and prophets. I love to work with teenagers. I had a teen retreat in Montana last Friday and Saturday. And had a ball. We saw two teenagers come to Christ. This one teenager, if I'd have been a betting man, I'd have laid $100 on the table saying, that kid is rebellious, that kid is not listening. I think he was mocking. And he got saved the first session. I talked with him later in front of a bunch of his buddies. I said, what'd you do tonight? He says, I received Jesus Christ as my Savior tonight. Had revival meetings in Prudence, Michigan. Prudenceville, Michigan. And a teenage girl came. I tried to make friends with her, and she just didn't want anything to do with me. Tried to give her my study notes, and she said, I don't want those. Wouldn't take them. I said, well, I can take it. No, I don't want it. And she finally got nasty with me. She came the first night. Parents made her come. Parents made her come the second night. Third night, they left her home. I said, well, where's Julie? Oh, she doesn't want to be here. And you know, there's really no sense in bringing her. She doesn't want to be here. Excuse me? The Holy Spirit of God does not need your permission. Whether it's a teenager or adult, whether it's a preacher or a bishop, the Holy Spirit of God does not need your permission to use His Word to convict. I love to teach parents. I think teens should have a choice when it comes to going to church. They can go glad or they can go mad. Old M.R. DeHaan. M.R. DeHaan said, if you want to convince a person of the power of a lion, and he says, you have this, he says, don't give them an anatomy lesson on a lion. Don't tell them how far that lion can jump. Don't tell them how powerful the jaws are and how sharp the teeth are and how swift his shoulder is and the muscles in his shoulder. He says, don't do that. He said, if you want to convince someone of the power of a lion, open the cage. Praise God, we see a lot of people saved. Even these past 3 weeks, we've just seen a number of folks come to Christ. Praise the Lord. Use the word God. I had a fellow that finally came to Christ after 7 years of witnessing. And he told me when he came to Christ, he said, remember all those years? He said, I would even slam your Bible shut. He said, I don't believe that dusty old book. So you're witnessing to someone and they say, I don't believe that dusty old book. Oh, well, okay. Maybe I'll try to use my fifth grade oratory skills. Maybe I'll try to check them. No, it doesn't matter if they say they believe the Word of God or not. My mother-in-law, before she came to Christ, she told me that that Bible was written by a bunch of monks in a cave. I'm not speechless very often, but I just completely lost all train of thought, and I didn't know what to say to that. Bible's written by a bunch of monks in a cave. And she came to Christ a few years after that. We need to have a spirit of readiness, an attitude of readiness. Oh, look at verse 21 in James 1. It says, the engrafted word. And I want to be careful. I'm asking the Lord to help me with this illustration here. What does it mean, the engrafted word? Well, the more we obey the word of God, the more it's hold on us.
Amen.
I want to avoid saying it becomes natural, because that old sin nature, it just never really becomes natural, but it becomes more and more a part of us. How many of you have driven a standard transmission in a car or a tractor or something? Sure. You know, when you first start driving a standard transmission, if you drove 4 miles and someone said, how many times did you shift? You probably would have been able to tell them. Because every time you shifted, you had to concentrate on the clutch. You had to move it. You had to then let off the accelerator, put it in gear, step on the accelerator, let the clutch out. And God, I shifted 4 times. But after, and I learned to drive a standard transmission in Butte, Montana, in the mountains out there by Anaconda. I can tell you how many times I shifted in those early days. But after a while, it becomes more and more a part of you. Listen carefully. It never becomes an automatic transmission. You still have to do the right things. There's still disciplines you need to do. But it becomes more and more a part of you. I had revival meetings 3 weeks ago in Susie, Iowa. Young pastor up there, John and his wife, Tara Woodford. They're sharp. Just a young couple. She's 26 and she looks like she's 15. She's already had a career as a nurse. She said she was asked 10 times a day, are you old enough to be doing this? I can't imagine what she looked like back then. And what struck me is they seem to be, I was impressed that they're biblical thinkers. They just seem to, at this young age, they're thinking biblically. And when problems come and they shared some things with me and the work is going great guns, it was a Continental Baptist Missions work that just graduated last summer. And he's the first regular pastor, which implies that our CBN missionary pastor was a little irregular. And that's usually the case with church writers. Yeah. But they're biblical thinkers, and it's not that they always have to stop and think, because the word becomes more and more a part. Are there basic disciplines? Yes, there are. Does it ever become automatic? No, it doesn't. But it's the engrafted word. It becomes more and more a part of us. Luke chapter 24, verse 31 and 32. I just love this. I found this when I was a new believer. Walking with Jesus on the road to Emmaus. It says, their eyes were opened, and they knew him. And listen to this. And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us, by the way, and opened unto us the scriptures? That's still my desire, dear people. I need God to use his word to burn into my heart as he talked with us, as he opens up the scriptures to us. And I need my heart to burn within me as I have opportunities to preach or to share with others, or just in a devotional, I shouldn't say just devotional, but my heart would burn within us. Number one, dear people, are we receiving the Word of God with the possibility of repentance? Number two, with an attitude of readiness, a meekness. I'm going to be compliant. And if God's Word says this, then I'm going to obey. Thirdly, we need to receive God's Word with a responsiveness. Look at verse 22. You see, this is the action. Where the readiness is the attitude, here is the action. He says, be doers of the Word and not hearers only. Look at this. Deceiving your own selves. Who? My ears ought to go, whoa. If there was a possibility, and there was, that these early first century Christians were deceiving their own selves, that possibility is real today.
Amen.
That possibility is real today with Bill. And so my ears need to go perked up. Am I deceiving myself? You see, it's sad and tragic if someone else deceives you. But how much more tragic if we are self-deceived? So first I just park here and say, oh, if he warns them of that problem, what about me? So be doers of the Word and not hearers only. There's a possibility that's what I could be doing as a preacher. I could be a hearer only, deceiving my own self. And then in verse 23, he begins to tell us the wrong way to receive God's Word, the wrong way to listen to God's Word. But if any be a hearer of the Word and not a doer, he is like a man beholding. Mark that word, beholding. He is like a man beholding his natural face in a glass, in a mirror. I used to think, and I taught, that this man doesn't see himself. He looks in the mirror and doesn't even see himself. That's not true. He looks in the mirror and he does see himself. But he doesn't make any changes. It's like he's got egg on his face. And he just goes on his way. Well, we're back to the verse. Like a natural man beholding himself in the glass, he beholdeth himself. The word beholding and beholdeth here in verses 23 and 24, it means a casual glance. Now remember, we're talking about looking into the law of liberty. It's not just any old mirror, it's the mirror of God's Word. The word behold and beholding means a casual glance. It's real. It's comprehended. Yet no change takes place. Wow. So he says, don't do it that way. And straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. He just goes on his way and, physically speaking, walks around all day with some egg on his face. Doesn't even know. Verse 25 tells us the right way to do it. But whosoever looketh into, and there's a key word there, looketh into, a key phrase. Whosoever looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein. He, the guy who's doing it right, the lady who's doing it right, he, excuse me, being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, that is the work of the word, this man shall be blessed in his deed. This word means, this looketh into this phrase in verse 25, it means to give a careful inspection. It actually has the idea of bending over. Say, how does that apply? It's the same word that was used in John chapter 20, verse 5, when he went to the tomb. John went to the tomb. And it says, he, stooping down and looking in, same word, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying. How do you think John looked into that empty tomb? We just celebrated Resurrection Sunday. Authentic Christianity would fall like a house of cards if not for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. How do you think John looked into the tomb, that the tomb is here? And he heard that he is risen? So John just strolls by and says, yeah, must be. He bent down. He stooped over. He looked into. That's what we need to do spiritually. When we get to the Word of God, not just a casual, oh yeah, I've seen that verse before. But bend down. Stoop over spiritually. And the idea has, the eyes are intent. The eyes are set. We're looking steadfastly. We are examining carefully the Word of God. Do this. Do this, dear people. 2 Peter chapter 1. Beginning in verse 16, we should look there. 2 Peter chapter 1. It's talking about, well, we'll just read it. This is another passage that tells us of the book, where the book came from and what the book is. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16. We have not followed cunningly devised fables, when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, what do you mean, Peter? Oh, did you see it, Peter? Look at it. But were eyewitnesses of his majesty. What's he talking about here? Transfiguration. I was there. I saw it. For he received from God the Father honor and glory, and there came such a voice from him, from the excellent glory. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. I heard it, I saw it, I was there, said Peter. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the Holy Mount. And we may falsely think, wow, if I had been there. If I could have seen Jesus, if I could have seen the Transfiguration, what a testimony I could be today. What a powerful witness I could be today if I would have seen what Peter saw. And in, unless we're prone to think that wrong way, Peter corrects us. I get thrilled. I read this. This is amazing. Look at verse 19. We have a more sure word of prophecy. What's he talking about, class? The Word of God. What? Peter, what? You, one of the few who saw the transfiguration of Jesus Christ, you tell me that if we have a Bible, we have a more sure word of prophecy. Let me finish the thought. We have a more sure word of prophecy than if we had been there. Because we have a Bible, the book. That's amazing.
Amen.
That's amazing. We have a more sure word of prophecy than if I had actually been there at the Mount of Transfiguration. So let's evaluate, dear people. When you hear the Word of God, when you read the Word of God, when you study the Word of God, I had a dear old retired missionary come to me and say, Pastor, he says, you always tell us to read the Word of God. He says, the Bible never says to read it. It says to meditate, it says to study, it says to be diligent. And aren't computers great? I went home and put in read.
Amen.
And many, many times it tells us to read. Now, it's not the Reader's Digest, but read it. Read it to your kids. Esther? Wow! Good guys, bad guys. You can almost see the white hats and the black hats and the gallows.
Yeah.
Wow. Read the Word of God. Now, study it too. Memorize it. Meditate on it. But sometimes you might just want to read volumes and volumes and volumes. In my cabin last week in Montana, I'm building a cabin out of my own timber, and we cut the trees, and we have peeled the logs, and I have pictures, but I don't have pictures of my 7 grandchildren, so I better keep my priorities straight. And I just sat by that fire sometimes, just reading the Word, reading the Word, reading the Word, reading the Word. No deep study, just for my own good, for my own heart. Here's it. So are we reading the Word of God with repentance, number one, with readiness, number two, the attitude, and with responsiveness, the action, number three. Here's a test, and I'll be finished with this. Here's a test to evaluate. Is your knowledge of the Word of God? I realize I'm talking to preachers, preachers' wives. Is your knowledge of the Word of God making you more like Christ? That's a kind of a simple test. Now, don't deceive yourself. But that's a rule of thumb. That's a guideline. That's a benchmark, I should say, that I can help evaluate. Is my knowledge of the Word of God helping me be more like Jesus Christ? Or do I know enough? I can get by. I don't need to learn anymore. I can go to an ordination council and be the moderator. I don't need to learn anymore. Yes, I do. And is my knowledge of the Word of God, as I continue to learn, is it making me more like Jesus? Let's pray together, please. Father in heaven, help us, we pray. Help us in our response to the book, to this holy book. Dear people, as your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, I also believe the Word of God is such that it demands a response. And I know we're preachers, but I would just offer to pray for you if you made some decisions today. Nothing magical about my prayer, you know that. And can you make a decision without letting me know? Well, of course. I'm your brother in Christ. I'm not your priest. And yet, I don't exactly know how it works. The psychology of it, more than that, the spirituality of it. But sometimes it's just helpful to let others know we've made a decision. And I would offer this. If you've made a decision today in regard to the Word of God, I'll not give you my outline again, but if you've made a decision, and if you'd like me to pray for you, I won't call you by name, but if you'd like me to pray for you, just slip your hand up and slip it right back down. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. A number of us, guys, ladies, I've got to say us, because I can't study this. I can't study this book and make a sermon like this and not be affected myself. This will be the last time that I ask. Are there others? You just slip your hand up and say, Brother Bill, I made a decision today. I need you to pray for me. I will. Amen. Father in heaven, thank you. Thank you for the men, the women, and even the children today who've made some kind of a decision. And we thank you that you know more about that than I do. Really, you know more about that than they do. So I just pray that whatever that decision is, if they do need some help with that, that they would seek someone out that could help them. And likely getting all the help they need from you and through your blessed Holy Spirit. And so we thank you. We pray in Christ's name.